Hi, and welcome to the HVACR Distillery. We're going to start this new series with a focus on refrigerants. Now, why refrigerants? Well, probably the easiest way to answer that is just by taking a look behind me here. This is the compressor equipment or the mechanical room for a ice rink. So behind me here, we have these compressors. They run off a refrigerant called ammonia. And then over on this side here to the right, we have our secondary loop, which is a glycol or brine that they actually pump out under the ice and cool it. So the main important thing here is, if you look at this equipment, it is exactly the same or shares something in common with all refrigeration, air conditioning, and heat pump equipment. So whether it's this industrial refrigeration setup behind me, or the air conditioning in my car or my home, or even one of those little portable dehumidifiers that you can buy at, you know, a hardware store that you fire off into your basement in the summertime, they all have one thing in common, and that is they utilize the refrigeration cycle. And every refrigeration cycle utilizes and, in fact, requires the use of a refrigerant to move heat around. Now, what exactly do I mean by moving heat around? Well, think about it this way. If I want to cool something, say like my house here, in the summertime where heat's building up, I got to take that heat and move it somewhere else. All right, in which case it means it's got to go outside. So the air conditioning system uses refrigerant to absorb heat from inside, and then that refrigerant carries that heat outside to this unit here, where that heat is rejected, and it goes through what we call a change of state. And as we'll learn in future episodes, when something goes through a change of state, it can give up or absorb a lot of energy without actually changing temperature. The temperature that occurs at is based on pressure. So by controlling the pressure that occurs in, you know, the condenser here or the evaporator inside, we can actually control the process to a large degree, including how much humidity you remove versus how you just cool the air sensibly and things like that. Now, refrigerants are the lifeblood of a system, and they have been for a long time. To have a refrigeration system, you need something to act as a refrigerant. And refrigerants are chosen by a lot of different, based on a lot of different reasons. Their pressure temperature curve, whether they're toxic or not, whether they're flammable or not, and of course, how efficient they are. In other words, how much heat they absorb for a given amount. Say, you know, how many BTUs per pound does R134A absorb, you know, changing from a liquid to a vapor versus 404 or 410, all right? This adds up to the, or equals the efficiency of the system. Now, if refrigerants have been around for a long time and they've been, you know, the lifeblood of the system, that doesn't mean that the same refrigerants have been around forever. In fact, some of the early refrigerants were pretty nasty stuff. When you think about methyl chloride or sulfur dioxide, not only do they smell really bad, but they're actually quite toxic as well. So if, you know, you had a refrigerator in your house, for example, and it sprung a leak, these toxins could be very irritable to the respiratory system, and high concentrations are quite deadly. So when the invention of chlorofluorocarbons came around in the 1920s and 30s, it was hailed as a huge invention. It was a big deal because suddenly you had these refrigerants that weren't nearly as noxious, they weren't toxic, they had no odor, and they were quite efficient. And they allowed mass production of refrigerators and freezers, especially after the Second World War, which allowed people to move away from the icebox. Now, this ability of the cold chain to be completed from the producer to the end user was huge. In fact, it'd be pretty hard to overstate the effect this had, because the amount of food spoilage or food waste that occurred after that cold chain was put in place dropped dramatically. And this meant that a lot more food could make it to the table and be consumed, you know, per given amount that was grown. So it made the whole system a lot more efficient. Now, as you know, CFCs have been out for a while, and they were replaced by something called HFCs. You know, hydrofluorocarbons. And these refrigerants came in not because the CFCs weren't efficient, but because of the effect they had on the environment. Now, I'm not just talking about the air conditioning refrigeration industry. CFCs were widely used as blow-in agents for insulation, forming processes. The automobile industry was a massive user of CFCs. And the vast majority of this, if not all of it, was just vented straight to the atmosphere. So there was millions of tons of CFCs being released. That whole practice is gone now. The fact that it's not being released is a huge deal. And the adoption of HFCs got rid of this problem with the ozone layer, which was a serious issue and it was growing quickly. So now you have a new refrigerant that does exactly the same thing as the old refrigerants did, but they don't have the same drawbacks. There's some challenges with them, okay, in the type of oil and things like that, but there's also benefits. So when you look at an HFC and a POE oil refrigerant, polyester refrigerant, you don't have the same types of acids and things like that being produced. So going forward, as you can see, we've just touched the tip of the iceberg here. There's a lot of things we can look into in more depth in future episodes. So we'll look at these different types of refrigerants. We'll look at what a refrigerant actually does, you know, in the evaporator, in the condenser, how we store it, things like that. We'll look at what makes a good refrigerant. What are some of the new refrigerants coming out? And keep in mind that some of these new refrigerants are actually old refrigerants that are making a comeback because they happen to have certain benefits that actually outweigh the risks, okay? So on top of that, we'll look at choosing refrigerants. We'll look at the different types that are out there. And again, what exactly makes a good refrigerant, say for medium temp applications to low temp applications. So we got lots of stuff to look into, a lot of things to cover. So I really hope you can join me in these future episodes. Till then, stay safe, and I look forward to talking to you soon. Thank you.